Let us take a moment to relax and catch our breath. Let's bring our focus here, to this room, to this group of people, and to this moment. We bring a myriad of talents, ideas, needs, and styles. Yet within this diversity, there is a common bond between us. We love this fellowship, and we are willing to work together to improve and strengthen this community of ours and our lives. It is good to be together again today. Today we start a new week. So, how was last week for you? Was there some joy, some sorrow, some hope, some grief? Have you arrived this morning feeling grateful and upbeat, or maybe stumped by something that sapped your spirit? While we listen to the prelude, come, whoever you are, and light a candle, should you wish. May the simple act of lighting a candle soothe the rough edges or brighten the bliss. Please stand in body or spirit as we say together the spoken affirmation that urges us to grow our souls and serve the world. Then remain standing as we light our chalice. The words for our affirmation are printed in the morning program. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law. This is our great covenant, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth and freedom, and to help one another. I kindle this flame as a reminder of the affirmation we just said, because we do affirm that love is our greatest purpose and that accepting one another is the truest form of faithful living, and we strive to keep the search for truth as our constant star. We pledge our hearts, minds, and hands to challenge injustice with courage, to find hope in times of fear, and to live out our Unitarian Universalist values every day as a beloved community. Thus do we covenant with each other and with all that is sacred in life. Please be seated. Our opening thought comes from Why Poetry, an essay written by Matthew Zapruder that he actually wrote on August 15, 2017, 4 years ago today. He writes, "The French philosopher Paul Valéry once wrote, 'A poem is really a kind of machine for producing the poetic state of mind by means of words.' Valéry's description has always seemed to me to be as close as anyone has gotten to describing what poems can do. If the term machine shocks you, if my mechanical comparison seems crude, please notice that while the composition of even a very short poem may absorb years, the action of the poem on the reader will take only a few minutes. In a few minutes, the reader will receive his shock from discoveries, connections, glimmers of expression that have been accumulated during months of research, waiting, patience, and impatience. The poem makes poetry happen in the mind of the reader or listener. It happens first to the poet, and in the course of writing, the poet eventually makes something, a little machine. One that for the reader produces discoveries, connections, glimmers of expression. Whatever it does, it can do again and again as many times as we need it." This morning, we welcome back Oklahoma poet Ron Wallace. We are so happy to see he has brought Jane, his wife, with him. We welcome you both. You can read Ron's biography in the morning program. And Ron, it is always a pleasure to see you. It's a pleasure to see you again. And welcome back. And we invite you to speak to us right here, right now.
It's always a pleasure to be here. God, I hate these things. But as I told Albert when I was a baseball player and a catcher, I also hated a catcher's mask, but I sure as hell put it on. there's a point to stupidity, and sometimes you just need to draw a line. I wasn't really sure where to start. Never am. I kind of wing this as I go, so if I get to sounding like I'm hunting something, I probably am. I thought I'd start off with a quote by the great prophet Ray Wiley Hubbard, who wrote the immortal classic Up Against the Wall, Redneck Mother. Hubbard said, you got to have scars if you want to be a poet. I got that covered. That's about all I got covered. I'm still trying to be a poet. According to the introduction, I'm a cowboy poet. I have to correct that right now because cowboy poets get really ticked off when they think I'm claiming to be a cowboy poet. They write in structured, metered verse, and I've been introduced as a cowboy poet dozens of times, and it's always okay unless there's actually a cowboy poet there, and then the fight has to start. So this first poem is called, I Am Not a Cowboy Poet. I am not a cowboy poet, but at times I kind of want to be. Now, those guys are way more disciplined than me. Man, I swear Shakespeare would be real proud of that stuff. Now, I do love my blue jeans and my old John B. Stetson hat. But rhyme and meter, they almost always manage to elude me. Every time I try to rope and ride them, they toss me ass over ears and make a run for the gate. And the good Lord knows that I can't even start to grow that Baxter Black mustache. So what I'm going to do is just keep writing about horses and the men who ride them day in, day out. I'll pitch in a line or two concerning the quality of good leather boots, saddles to fit my backside, or spurs and latigos. I'll try to paint the night sky in Oklahoma, Texas ponies on the run, maybe the deserts of New Mexico. And if someone calls me a cowboy poet, I'll just touch my hat brim and grin and thank them for the compliment. The other one is, I guess, what I actually am. The biggest compliment ever on this, Billy Letts told me it was her favorite poem of mine. It explains the cowboy thing. I'm definitely not a cowboy. I am a cowboy wannabe. I Come From Cowboys is the title of it. I come from cowboys, and I don't like ties. Boots and blue jeans fit me best when I head out the door. I'm carved wood, sculpted stone, tooled leather. I'm green trees, blue sky, native earth, a circling red-tailed hawk. My dad taught me how to read, how to swing a hammer, and cast a fishing line. Mama taught me how, not what, to think. She said, keep it simple, son. Always try to do the best you can. The world gets complicated as it is without you chipping in. 50 years have marked me now with scars of bent 10-penny nails, fist fights, and books of poetry. But in the end, when the wind moves the grass across my grave, I ask only that I rise on feathered wings one time and loose a last defiant cry before I'm gone back into the stone below the dirt to sleep a while. So that's where the cowboy images all come from. This was my last book, by the way. It was a 2019 Oklahoma Book Award finalist. It lost. I'm used to losing. I've been a finalist 5 times, but I did win one. I'm not supposed to consider it a loss. It's supposed to be an honor to be a finalist, but I told you earlier I was a baseball player. If you don't win, you lose. So I was a little disappointed as always, but what the heck. This other poem is about one of the cowboys, the real cowboys that I come from. It's about my grandfather, who was shot by a bounty hunter. He was escaping from McAllister, where he was serving life for a misdemeanor or murder, I'm not sure which. Actually, it was murder. He was shot when my father was about just about 11 years old. My father grew up to be a cop, served 30 years in law enforcement. I tell my students it skips a generation. They have to be very careful with me. It's entitled Heartsworn Oklahoma, April 17th, 1917, for John William Wallace, the day he was killed. Your bones lie beneath graveyard ground where I stand on rain-wet grass that grows above your stoneless sleep. And I listen, listen for dark echoes, the rifle fire that summoned you 9 decades ago to lie beneath this Oklahoma soil. Grandfather, I have seen, locked in sepia-toned shades of gray, those Wallace eyes, watching from another age. I am the son of your son, and I have come to find you, not lying here in hardened earth, nor buried in arcane pages, but living in my muscle and my blood, your heart moving my legs to pace above your crypt. Your eyes looking out from that old photograph were my father's eyes. Now they're mine, peering from beneath a wide brim, pulled low, a trickle of rain cascading down to the dirt above you. Someday soon, with a few more creases, they will be my sons, studying the roll of dark clouds over land where he stands, listening for echoes. Okay, that was the part I prepared for. Now comes the hunting. I'm going to switch books to the one that won. This book was in poetry. This is a cheater's book. I already had most of the stuff written in other books, about half of it, and my publisher wanted to do a themed book, one of all cowboy stuff, so I took all of my old cowboy poems, and there were quite a few, and added them to a bunch of new ones that I had been writing, and this book came about. This book was at the time all new, and it was, I think it won because of the picture of my son, by the way. It was entitled Renegade, which was the poem, was a pushcart nominee poem. It was originally titled Desperado. Then I bought a little Jeep Renegade, and I thought, wow, that's a whole lot cooler name. And I changed it from Desperado to Renegade, and it got nominated for a pushcart. So you never know. I'm going to read the poem, the title poem, Renegade. It's very short. Maybe that was telling me that I should write shorter poems. I don't know. Renegade. November rides in from the east on a blood bay mare, iron spur rowel rattling, the black brim of his Stetson pulled low above hard hazel autumn eyes. Behind him, the sky is wearing bones, a line of leafless sycamores etched against the graying day in a time of outlaws. Well aware, the cold is on his heels. He watches as a rising crescent moon lifts the black above not yet winter hills, cocks the hammer back, and buries the world under collapsing stars. Believe it or not, that was supposed to be a description of snow. So, one more, and I'm going to turn it back to Dan here. This is a personal favorite, and I don't get to read it very often because it's about my son, and I'm forbidden to read about him when he's present. It's called A Game of Catch. We're playing catch in the not too cold of January before you leave. Between the throw and the catch and the throw, ribbons of light ride from ball to glove, binding us. It is in these moments I feel the blood in my veins being carried in that spinning sphere, humming toward you, racing father to son on winter light, connecting life in flicker and flash, sun on letter. I know spring will find Colorado a further throw than my aging arm could ever make. So today, I am content to step outside and toss a baseball back and forth across our 30 feet of fallen leaves here in Oklahoma, keeping us who we are, stitching the Red River to the Rocky Mountains.
Thank you, Ron. Every week in our church, we take up an offering. It's good to remind ourselves from time to time that the offering is symbolic as well as practical. We know that it is through pledges that we build our budget and fund our yearly programs and ministries of worship, outreach, social justice, and fellowship, along with financing the comfort and beauty of this stately old house we call our church home. But we take up an offering during our morning assembly to make a community expression of thanks for the blessing of abundance, to visibly bring in the harvest at this most cherished hour of our week. Our offering says that the act of giving is as essential to growing our soul as anything else we do here on Sunday mornings. The bowl awaits our gifts, as does the church app, by typing the donate tab on the home screen. All right, we're happy to welcome back Ron for the second portion of his readings for us today.
I have all these books for sale, by the way, if y'all want to throw money at me. This book is a book that I edited. I was not writing enough, and I thought that if you can't write, edit. So I started to contact most of the people that I knew in Oklahoma, and this book wound up being Bull Buffalo and Indian Paintbrush, the Poetry of Oklahoma. All profits, as soon as we make any, are going to Howard Stark's scholarship at Southeastern. I have a couple of his poems in here that I stole. Joy Harjo, the poet laureate of the United States, contributed a poem, didn't even charge me. I had to sign a contract that said if anybody got paid, Norton Publishing got paid. For her and in Scott Mama Day, that was no problem. Nobody was getting paid. So it has some very interesting poems by some very interesting people in it. And of course, since I was the editor, I put one of my own in there. But it's well worth it. If you've ever heard of a poet in Oklahoma, he's probably in that book, at least a contemporary one. And I'm going to now, hopefully, if you don't mind, use you for guinea pigs. Most of this stuff that I'm going to read in this section here is new. Heretofore unsprung upon humans, except for my wife, and she's semi-human. And thankfully, a very poor shot. This book, by the way, will be dedicated to her for being a very poor shot. And the first poem I'm going to read is the title piece of this particular poem. When I first started talking to Dan about doing this, this was primarily what I was focusing on. The title of the new book right now, and pretty definitely, as a matter of fact, I got to make a decision within a month, is going to be Sanctuary. And it's a poem about a house that stood in a field by where I grew up that was falling down. The entire second floor ceiling had fell down except for one little section. So you couldn't get up on the second floor. And being a boy of 13, 14, and 15, about the years before it finally collapsed, I wondered what was up there on that little section of the second floor. And conveniently, there was a chinaberry tree that I could climb. And I went up there and found a section not much bigger than this dais here that I could occasionally just sit in, play the radio, and escape. And I went back looking for it a few years ago, and it was, of course, gone. There is nothing there anymore. But this poem came out of that. Sanctuary. Indian grass is mingled among the Bermuda, not yet ready to mow. Round bales from an early cutting stand in the southern corner of the pasture where I am walking, seeking remnants of the old house. In my memory, the ruins had lain just past a stand of blackjacks and bodarks across a little creek on the edge of childhood. Moving parallel to the abandoned railroad track west of the field, I see the bright orange flame of Indian paintbrush splitting coyote bones returning to earth. The decaying gray remains of the predator fertilizing the wild flowers. Half a century away, the unroofed walls once stood, two-storied, with a crumbling chinaberry tree pressed to its western wall. I climbed those limbs more than once, to swing inside an empty window and stand on a delicate fraction of a second floor, mostly fallen to rubble below me. June was exploding as I sat on the unreliable fragment of 1969, peering into the blue future collapsing faster than the eastern wall of my embryonic nest among the ruins. Credence rocking my transistor radio, blasting the summer like a detonation of distant claymores. But this June, 50 years flown, finds me crossing a dry stream bed, stand in knee-high pasture grass, unable to find a trace of the place that did its best to shelter my teenage self from the death and destruction, living in black and white television. Even the antique chinaberry has fallen into the past. Nothing remains of my sanctuary, only the menace of the 21st century and the bright orange flames grown through coyote bones see me now, still searching for shelter. It's a lot easier when you have a book. Sad and depressing, sticking with that theme. This is a poem called Comes November. It's for my dog. It made a very large man cry in Ada. Makes me cry sometimes too, so I may not make it through it, but I'm going to give it a shot. Comes November. Outside my window, October lies, defeated, broken, awaiting the cold. The gray sky has buried the blue beneath the chill rain, and the lawn is lost in leaves, dampened by this christening of autumn. Among hickory, blackjack oak, and American elm, I walk where leaves are falling, reluctant to surrender summer, a futile resistance to the impending close of seasons. And I find you beneath the overhang of short roof near our southern door. On your much-loved, worn-out blanket, my hand falls to your head and scratches beneath your standing ears as you try to rise and meet me one more time. But you cannot. Your strength is gone. As we sit, your head resting on my folded legs as I speak soft words until you look up right into my eyes, offering a sad apology for a warrior's weakness. Behind our southern hills, I sense December's shadow coming to swallow shorter suns. And my fingers recall soft fur, black on tan. I sit back on boot heels to brush away leaves, covering a cinder block that marks your grave, where you sleep. My reflection is closed in brown eyes. Once more, speak in soft tones, telling you of the squirrels that you would chase, the golden leaves you would race among. And as always, I sense your rising and know you have kept me in those dark eyes as I have kept you in mine. And you, for just a brief flickering, will walk winter's edge with me before you rest and await my return. That dog's been gone 20-something years. Trying to find something funny now, because I need it. But what the heck, once you're depressed, just stay that way. This one, by the way, some people, when I read this, worry a lot. It is not about suicide. Okay. Prefacing this is definitely not. I have no suicidal tendencies whatsoever. If that's ever ruled as my cause of death, I expect someone to hunt the murderer. It's called Tiger, with the same spelling as William Blake. And it's prefaced with an epigraph by John Keats, which I think is what worries everybody. When I have fears that I may cease to be. John Keats. I've reached a place where days drop like Greek soldiers from the belly of a wooden horse. And I try to unravel shards of memory, hoping to understand how I've come to be who I am. I am the son of an Okie cop, born into outlaw territory. But I am not my father, an unstoppable force of nature. I am more my mother, who forged her own rules, right or wrong in another's eyes, always right in hers. The road is ending, and I sense an elemental gathering of should-have-beens and might-have-beens, signaling the impending arrival of the never-will-bes. And often, on cold winter days just before dawn, I sense the eyes of Blake's tigers flickering red against the black, teeth gleaming. I hear him padding out there on the periphery, where he pauses like a specter on the edge of darkness and beckons me to join him in that void where all things are swallowed. And I am sometimes tempted to enter his shadow world, step up and place my hand gently on his fur.
Wow. For our practices today, a brief reading from a book called Try to Love the Questions Themselves, which is from Letter 4 and Letters to a Young Poet. It seemed fitting for today's Poetry Sunday. Have patience with everything unresolved in your heart and try to love the questions themselves, as if they were locked rooms or books written in a very foreign language. Don't search for the answers, which could not be given to you now, because you would not be able to live them. And the point is to live everything. Live the questions now. Perhaps then, someday far in the future, you will gradually, without even noticing it, live your way into the answer. Let's share some time in quiet sitting. I think you can see why we like to invite Ron Wallace to speak to us so frequently. And we'd like to invite him for the third section of his readings, of his creations. And then after that, I'll be happy to facilitate an open dialogue with any questions that remain. Ron?
I'm going for a lighter note this time. I didn't expect the dog poem to get me that bad. This is entitled New Orleans for Jane. I'm not sure who Jane is, but it just came to me. New Orleans. You gave me this city 30 years ago, bewitched me with iron-laced galleries above arcane streets, music, and food drifting in from French-quartered doorways. Every year since then, we have walked beneath antique oaks that witnessed duels fought over beauty such as yours. Here, I have seen the sky on fire above the Mississippi, and often walked with your hand in mine, the white light of a full moon pursuing us along black water waves as we stroll. But tonight, we walk from the alley of pirates to stand on these stones before this cathedral. Beneath two contrails above a three-quarter moon slipping through ragged clouds, the past swallows all as we watch painters, poets, and jugglers mingle with angels and horrors and the ghosts of both. It is in this moment, with a steady clop of horse hooves before an unseen carriage, at last I understand this portal and know why one hand holds yours like gold and the other becomes familiar with a pistol grip. Baseball and the game of catch is, since I'm too old to play baseball, the game of catch has always fascinated me. This is called The Weight of Horsehide. Carrying gloves into the sun, the weight of horsehide born in a throwing hand, we seek a lightness of being, known only when one throws a baseball and receives sacrament on its return. My fingertips kinship to leather and raise red threads stitch the past to the present like a tailor's needle, fastening an elemental fabric of the heart to the arm. We release ourselves, our humanity, across space and time, turning two into one, welding souls, lifting burdens, bringing momentary peace to a world sheathed in the cold reality of chaos. I've got one here I'm going to read that I told Dan I was going to read, which is highly irreverent. And he said, read it and use all the language. And my wife said, no. We compromised. I won't drop the F-bomb. I think it'll be just as effective without it. I'll signal you. She prepares my meals. I'm sorry. It's called What Moses Should Have Said. 1. Thou shalt. Thou shalt teach children how to think, not what to think. Thou shalt laugh often and not be afraid to cry when needed. Thou shalt know exactly how much alcohol it takes to turn you into an asshole. Then stop 2 drinks before the limit, just in case. Read some of Emerson, most of Faulkner, and all of Steinbeck. Thou shalt heed the words of Woody Guthrie, this land is truly your land. And always treat the janitor like the superintendent. No, wait. Treat him better. He's less likely to be a son of a bitch. You must remember other people have had bad days, sometimes even worse than yours. Sit tall in the saddle and always try to make a hand. Wear well your scars and never forget an injurious truth is worse than a kind lie. Thou shalt never forget the words of Ian Tyson. There is no point in writing bullshit. Dream. Thou shalt learn to distinguish the soldier from a man who simply wears a uniform. And the same goes for policemen. Thou shalt protect what you love and love the things that deserve protection. Love blue skies and green trees. Feel the rain on your skin. Watch the clouds run across the stars at night and make love on the shore where the moon is in the water. Laugh. Thou shalt believe in baseball, books, and beer, the things most holy. Keep your glove well oiled and at hand. One never knows when a game of catch might break out. Thou shalt always tip your waitress or your waiter appropriately. Never fail to make your mama proud. And as someone once said, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. Thou shalt not, part two. Thou shalt not hesitate to sacrifice your bishop for your queen. Do not speak ill of others, unless they really deserve it. Thou shalt not be offended by words. Okay. F it. They're just words. Instead, be offended by acts, cruelty, racism, sexism, injustice. These are real offenses. Thou shalt not turn the other cheek. You'll most likely just get hit again. Do not abide a bully in any form. Thou shalt not pull back on your reins as your horse is leaping. But don't be afraid to change your mind, nor to question the majority. Thou shalt not forget you're just a man, better than some, worse than others. You will be right and you will be wrong. Just do the best you can. Never dance with the devil, but sometimes give his lady one quick spin. Thou shalt not be foolish enough to believe that rules only come in sets of 10. Numbers mean very little when it comes to rules, but quite a lot on the back of a uniform. Thou shalt not believe everything you hear. If it's on Fox News, don't even believe what you see. Thou shalt not bear false witness. Hell, Moses got one right occasionally. Thou shalt not draw to an inside straight. And never trust the Queen of Diamonds. Boy, she'll beat you if she's able. Henley and Fry got a lot of things right. Probably more than Moses. Don't read badly written books. You only have so much time. 100 pages in and you hate it? Drop it like a hot rock. Don't go chasing curveballs in the dirt. You won't hit them. That's why good pitchers throw them. Thou shalt never mention Waylon Jennings in the same breath with Luke Bryan, for it is akin to blasphemy. do not fail to recognize songwriters or poets. Some aren't very good poets, but just poets all the same. Most importantly, heed this very closely. Thou shalt not drive your truck with your spurs on. Yeah, and I will close with this, and we'll take some questions. Guy Clark wrote a lot of stuff, but one of my favorite songs of his says, poetry is what sets the poet free. There ain't no money in poetry. That's what sets the poet free, but I've had about as much of this freedom as I can stand. And Clark's somebody probably worth quoting. This poem is called "How the Hell Did I Get Here?" A question I ask myself almost daily when I'm teaching freshmen daily. How the hell did I get here? Here, to this blue ending of summer. When last I took my bearings and checked my compass, I was bending curveballs around the corner of July, or chasing two gray eyes that laughed at me from beneath dark gypsy curls. Now, every time I pass a jukebox or turn on a radio, I hear Willie Nelson singing, "Ain't it funny how time slips away?" Hell, ain't any of these DJs ever heard of J.J. Cale? They call me the breeze. One wrong turn, coming out of Colorado, blowing smoke to all four corners of the sky, and a man winds up surrounded by a pack of overripe evangelicals beating Bibles into bayonets and breathing fire. How the hell did I get here? I swear I never saw the road sign, never heard the warning horn, just stepped out of the smoke and wreckage and heard the sirens wail. Thank you.
So everyone, including those watching our morning assembly on Zoom, can easily hear. So everyone can hear. If you have a question or comment for Ron, please either get out of your seat and come to the floor mic, or raise your hand and kindly wait for someone to bring the mic to you. Okay, open the floor now.
That's the exact same reaction I get when I ask my freshmen to do this.
Ron, when did you decide you wanted to become a poet? How young were you? And how many books have you written?
I've written 9 books. I edited one. This new one will be my 10th. I was actually writing, I guess, what might pass for poetry back when I was like 15 or 16. It was pretty terrible. No, it was awful. And then in college, I had Albert for a professor. I had Howard Starks and Dennis Letts. And Dennis read Running Boards by Howard Starks in my college class. I was a pre-law major. I was going to be a lawyer. Since then, I've decided I didn't want to sell my soul. My apology to all lawyers. I heard him read it, and I changed my major to that, and I began to write a little poetry. I wrote several in college. Dennis was at that time in charge of a little poetry thing there, and he was kind enough to put a few in, and then I just quit. And in 2004 or 5, I went back and started doing it again. I don't even know why. And I went through all the old stuff, and I had stacks of poems. And I, online, I entered 2 or 3 contests, and I won one that got me a publishing contract. And that was where my first book came from. And since then, I have just continued. And so.
Thank you. We have a question from a Zoom participant today. Are your poems one-offs? All right. Do you write your poems all at once, or do you write bits and pieces and edit them into a final version?
Definitely the latter. I have poems that the poet that you quoted earlier, Valeri, he said, a poem is never finished. It's simply abandoned. I have went back, like with Renegade, I'd written that poem as Desperado and went back and changed it and changed the title and everything. I write, basically, I find something that strikes me, and it may be a word. I mean, I've literally written poems after just coming across a word that sort of intrigued me or fascinated me, and I'm like, I've got to find a way to use this word because this is the coolest word I've ever found. Then I start looking for images. One of my books was criticized for not having enough imagery, which I went, I really kind of thought that's what I wrote, was imagery. It was, and I won't mention his name, but he is a well-known writer. He has written 2 books of poetry, and they both suck. They're terrible. Because I went and read them after he critiqued mine. I thought, well, let me see what I've done to offend you. And I went and read his, and his were, I really, and I don't think it was bias. I really just don't think, I just didn't enjoy his poetry very much. It was very bland, and I thought, you're calling me no imagery, and I haven't found an image in one of your poems yet. But I got over it. No, I didn't. You can tell I didn't. you know, James Dickey said, find something that only you can say. And that struck me. And then again, he said what I use in all of my composition classes, write what you want to say. And that's a hard thing to explain to people. It's easy. Just the hard part is figuring out what you want to say. And then just write what you want to say. Most of us can get the basic English words down on paper. And I rewrite mine frequently. I do a lot of editing.
How often do you find that you're writing a poem, Ron? Do you have dry spells when you can't just, you maybe have an idea, but you can't crystallize it into a poem? How does that work?
Usually I just bang my head on a wall. Sometimes things come to me that I want, that there are ideas that I have, and I never throw anything away, okay? I write stuff down, and then I try to shape it, form it. I look for the traditional techniques, I look for metaphor, I look for allusions, I look for anything that might fit there better than the simple language. Usually I just start writing it in prose. And then I start to move it from out of prose into poetry. And I have plenty of stuff that is never crystallized, that is just never, I've never been able to do. I'm not one of these people who write every day. Sometimes I'm a guy who sits and stares at the computer every day. I mean, because I write everything on the computer. I use the keyboard and the deal. I seldom use longhand anymore.
Ron, thank you very much for your time and for sharing your writing with us. And we will be coming to the conclusion of today's program.
Again, I want to thank y'all for having me. This is always one of my favorite venues to read at.
Red River Valley originally was printed in 1896 as In the Bright Mohawk Valley, and a pencil manuscript of the verses in Iowa dates from Brewster M. Hiley, 1879. But research by folklorist Edith Falk reveals the song actually refers not to the Mohawk Valley in New York State or the Red River Valley in Texas, as many assumed, but to the Red River in Manitoba, Canada, that flows into Lake Winnipeg. Falk argues the song was sung in that region around 1870. Feel free to sing along if you remember the lyrics.
Come and sit by my side. Not hasten to bid me adieu, but remember the Red River Valley and the cowboy that loves you so true. From this valley, they say you are leaving. We will miss your bright eyes and sweet smile. For they say you are taking the sunshine that's brightened our pathway a while. Come and sit by my side if you love me. Do not hasten to bid me adieu. Remember the Red River Valley and the cowboy that loves you so true.
Please rise in body or spirit for our parting thought and extinguishing the chalice. In the end, it won't matter how much we have, but how generously we have given. It won't matter how much we know, but rather how well we live. And it won't matter how much we believe, but how deeply we love. We extinguish this flame, but not the light of truth, the warmth of community, or the fire of commitment. These we carry in our hearts until we are together again.